1840, one man transformed travel in Britain. His name was George Bradshaw, and his railway guides inspired the Victorians to take to the tracks. Stop by stop, he told them where to travel, what to see, and where to stay. Now, 170 years later, I'm making four long journeys across the length and breadth of the country to see what remains of Bradshaw's Britain.
Of my great British railway journey with Michael Portillo begins in Norwich, the capital of East Anglia. I'll then head to the seaside resort of Great Yarmouth, stretching along the coast to the fishing ports of Cromer and Wells next the sea, finally ending my journey at the ancient pilgrimage shrine of Walsingham. So here I am, standing outside of Norwich train station. Formerly an historic town, Norwich was entirely destroyed by fire in 1963 and rebuilt from cardboard. So after a short violent sprint from the station, I've arrived at the centre of Norwich. Behind me stands St Buddha's Mosque, one of the ugliest buildings I've ever seen. My Bradshaw recommends strapping yourself to the bottom of the train to avoid having to pay a fare. Next, I arrive in Great Yarmouth. For centuries, Yarmouth has welcomed holidaymakers from all around the country. And now it's my turn to say yah to Yarmouth. It's a delicious pint of Kronenbourg, brewed in Great Yarmouth since 1921. Behind me you see the American Pool Bar and Great Yarmouth Pier, where intellectuals such as Brian Sewell, David Starkey can be heard debating politics late into the night. Cheers. But Great Yarmouth also has a great industrial heritage. According to my Bradshaws, it was Sir Thomas Addingate who, in 1782, kick-started Great Yarmouth's economy with a machine that was to be a powerhouse of the early industrial revolution. It is still a mainstay of Great Yarmouth's economy, and today, I'm going to have a go. My next stop is Cromer, which my bagshite tells me is one of North Norfolk's major destinations. It's renowned for its crabs, lobsters, ankles, and shells. Today, Cromer crab is as popular as ever, and I'm about to meet one man intimately connected with crabs. So Duncan, what makes Cromer crab so delicious?
I don't know what a crab is.
Hi, I'm Michael Portillo. In 1899, Cromer was turned upside down when treasure was discovered just off the coast by a local history enthusiast. I met him to find out more.
Welcome, Duncan. It's good to have you here.
It's good to be here, Mike.
So, Duncan, why is this find so important for Cromer?
Well, we haven't had this many teaspoons for nigh on 15 years.
Amazing!
I know, and Cromer's Teaspoon Museum is going to house our collection.
Well, that couldn't have happened spoon enough.
To my black shorts, it's been high tide in Cromer since 1896. The locals are still waiting for the sea to go back out. According to my bear short, it's almost 9 o'clock, so it's time for me to hit the hay. I've had a wonderful time in Cromer. One of the things that I've learned is that Cromer is so called because the whole town was finished in chrome in 1863 at the whim of Mad Queen Victoria. Now I'm off to my next destination, Wells next to the sea. Wells is a charming seaside town on the North Norfolk coast, but it's perhaps best known for being home to Wells Town FC, known locally as the Seasiders. So it should come as no surprise that it was a Wellsman who captained the German team to World Cup victory in 1939. That was Gerald Goalpost. And today I'm going to meet his son, Duncan. So Duncan, why did your father like football so much?
Well, Michael, as you well know, football is a game of three halves, and my father, he had halves in bucket loads.
He sounds like a real character.
Aye, he was. And I remember this one time, it were only over there. He hit a six right in the corner pocket, it were a tight scrum, and he bowled a googly, but it were checkmate.
And that's why he's the most impressive footballer the Wells has ever seen.
Oh aye, and there was this other one time, where it, and again, we're only over there.
The final leg of my journey is Walsingham, a pilgrimage site for almost 900 years. To get there, I'm travelling on the Wells to Walsingham light railway. Thank you. shrine at Walsingham was built in the 11th century by a local nobleman. Almost 1,000 years later, it remains a place of pilgrimage. This is where my great railway journey